Well, first, let me say what an honor and joy it is to be able to have this conversation with you on stage with this wonderful audience. Thank you for coming and joining us at Scripps today.
Well, I'm thrilled to have the chance. I hope I have some words left. I spent an hour with the young women who are students here at Scripps, and they asked all the questions.
Oh my.
And I said all the words, so
I hope they've left some for me.
Yeah, I hope there's something left in here, but here we go. So,
well, let me begin by going back to earlier this year, because I think many of us here miss your show on MSNBC. And miss the presence that you had there from 2012 and 2016. What I'd like to do is try to tie in a little bit some of the comments you made at the time with the theme of Sister Citizen, subtitled Shame, Stereotypes, and Black Women in America, and some of your thoughts on what occurred. So in one of your tweets, you addressed former hosts of color on the network saying, a few apologies, Martin Bashir, Touré, Finney Kay, Karen Finney, of her hosts who had departed before you. I am sorry for and ashamed of my earlier silence and I gave into a culture of fear at MSNBC. And that was on March 1st. And on March 2nd, CNN reported you as saying, they wanted us to cover politics in the narrowest sense. I told my team, we can't allow our own show to go off the air and then provide racial cover by having me continue to host the show so people see the little black girl up there, unquote. And so you're talking about tokenization. And it's also very clear that you're also talking about the fact that coverage of, I think this was in tandem with the racialization of the political scene leading up to the election that we are now in. And so could you comment a little bit about what gave you the courage to break with that code of silence and to be able to stand up for yourself, stand up for your past co-anchors, and to take back your name and also the right to speak out about what was going on?
Tenure?
That helps, that always helps.
So a couple of things. I wanna be careful about this. Mm-hmm. It's important to recognize that that much of the reporting, I think particularly that piece that CNN was probably reporting a couple of days later, was actually just them reporting from the letter I wrote to my team.
Okay.
So that letter was not supposed to be public. Mm-hmm. That was me writing to a group of people who I'd worked with for 4 years, mm-hmm. With whom I had an extraordinary relationship. Mm-hmm. Some people who I was saying to the young women I was talking with earlier, for whom I have the highest and continue to have the highest professional regard, mm-hmm. And who I had not seen in weeks. Mm-hmm. And I was making a decision. At that point, I'd gotten a phone call asking me to be on air. Mm-hmm. And I was making a decision not to go on air, and I felt that I owed them an explanation. So I was actually not providing an explanation to a public
sure.
audience. I was providing an explanation to my team. Mm-hmm. And I was doing that because we were coworkers, mm-hmm. and because I recognized that my decision not to go on air could impact them professionally.
Right.
They are mostly young women who don't have things like tenure mm-hmm. and other jobs. And I wanted them to understand why I was making that decision.
Mm-hmm.
You know, for people who know me, for my students, for that team, they know that I often write emails very swiftly, and that was a very spell-checked email. and so, evidence that I really wanted to take time and explain to them the decision that I was making. And then that email was leaked.
Right.
So part of what was going on there was just me having a conversation with my team. In the tweet where I'm talking about, so I don't know that that was courageous. That is more about accountability,
mm-hmm.
and particularly managerial and leadership accountability. I try to work hard in my various roles as director, as executive director, as professor, whenever I'm in a leadership role. I try to work hard to be accountable.
Mm-hmm.
I am not always, but I try to be. what I was explaining to them that became public, that I therefore ended up having to explain to other people, was that when I made the decision to take on a television show, you know, I'm not a journalist. Never taken a journalism course. Perhaps that was visible from my TV show. I'd never taken a journalism course. I wasn't interested in covering the news. I'm certainly not a reporter. The work that we were doing was not reporting. You know, we actually don't have journalists. CNN has some, MSNBC does not. Has some now, but certainly did not in that model. So it's not like there were people who would go out and report the news, right? You know, what you do is, like, mostly you read the paper, and then you would formulate opinions, and you put together a panel. So, like, it was what college professors do, right? You know, we, right? You bring together experts and form opinions and have conversations. And we wanted to do that on a broad set of topics about which electoral politics was one. And we had been given extraordinary, almost unicorn magical freedom to do that for 4 years. We knew it would eventually come to an end. We hoped that we would make it all the way through the election. It came to an end sooner than that. But we only wanted to do it while we had that editorial freedom. And I was signaling to them that that freedom was coming to an end swiftly. But I was reminding them that was what we said we were here to do. I have to stay true to what we said we were here to do. I know it's so hard because, man, a camera, who doesn't love a camera? We all love a camera. But we promised ourselves that that was what we were here to do. On the piece about my other colleagues, I'll just say this. I just talked to the students about this. We all participate in, all of us participate in systems that harm other people all the time. All the time. And we usually do it pretty thoughtlessly, like just don't even really think about it. My daughter is mostly a vegetarian. And would be more of one, except that I just need this kid to have more protein in her diet. You know, but for her, the decision was largely about watching some films and seeing the ways that our food system created harm. And so she just made a decision not to participate in that harm, right? But most people who, myself included, who are meat eaters, aren't thinking about, like, producing harm when we're eating lunch, right? We're just eating lunch. So, you know, for me, I was mostly going to work. And it really wasn't until the harm came to my front door in terms of the MSNBC thing, that I realized the ways in which my own silences were helping to produce that harm. Part of what I said to the students was, when we recognize that we have participated in an evil, it is important that we be accountable to it. We can't necessarily always fix it. We can't necessarily always create a reparation, but there is some necessity for public accountability. And that was at least some level of 140 characters of me trying to have some level of accountability for the ways in which I had participated in and not been accountable when I saw decisions made in corporate media where I was working.
But this is why I say that it was courageous, because having read your book, one of the things that struck me is that you detail, you know, using the literature or the research that other Black feminists have done in the past, to show us how even today there is still a structured manner in which African American women are delimited in their ability to pursue the goals that they would like to pursue. So yes, it's true that we are all in some ways part of this structure, but I think in Sister Citizen you demonstrate the ways in which even when Black women try not to be complicit with the system, they are somehow made to be complicit with it, and shame can be a part of it. So it seemed to me that some of those, even those things that were not meant to be public, they were moments that showed the rest of us how to stand up for ourselves. So that's one reason I think it was courageous. But to bring us to the book specifically, could you talk a little bit about a phrase that you bring up quite a bit, which is this idea of the crooked room? Could you tell us what that is and why you use it so extensively in the text?
So, you know, again, something I talked about with the students, they asked me, so it's kind of like the courage language. I have to be so careful because courage sounds like it's purposeful. I just want to be so clear that I wasn't necessarily behaving in a purposeful way. I would not change it if, even knowing everything, I wouldn't change anything that I did. No. I mean, I'm trying to think, would I use a different GIF? I would, you know, now that there are the lemonade GIFs, I would use them, but they didn't exist, you know, but I'm like, maybe I would have held on another month so that I could have used them, like that would have, because some of them are so good, but, yeah, okay, so I would have held on one more month so that I could have used the lemonade GIFs, but anyway, okay, that's the only thing I would have done differently. So let me talk about the crooked room. So the crooked room, just, you know, it's this idea that comes out of this cognitive psychology research, which is just, I think, very extraordinary research. It's not research about race or gender, right? It's actually about how our brains work, right? Which I always think our brains are very cool. So what the researchers would do is take the subject and put them in a dark room in a, like if you've ever been to like Universal Studios to the like simulator kinds of rides, okay, so it's kind of like that, right? But you're alone in this room, and you'd be in like a simulator movable chair. And then when they flip the light on, you'd be in this room that, in this chair that was on a tilt. But the room violated all of the expectations of your brain. So you expect in a room that you have right angles, right? And that the floor and the ceilings and the walls are parallel, right? So, and that, you know, things are hung on right angles and that kind of thing. So it looked like it was that kind of room, but it wasn't, right? So everything was basically crooked. It was askance. So your brain was taking in all of these angles that were off. And then the researchers were asking you to find the upright, right? So you, your job as the subject is to kind of move your chair around, right? Until it is straight up and down. So here's what our brains do. Particularly for people, it turns out, who are field dependent. So if you have a field dependent brain, you can be tilted on an angle, a pretty incredible angle, sometimes like as much as 45%. But if you are in line with the room's weird angles, then you will perceive yourself as straight up and down, even though you're all turned to the side. And you're like, oh, I got it, straight up and down, and you're like, tch-tch-tch. So it's cognitive psychology research about how our brains work. But the first time I heard a presentation about the research, I'm listening to that and I'm like, oh my God, that's exactly what it's like to be a black woman. Right? Because it felt to me like this metaphor of like we're constantly in this room where the images coming back to us are crooked, right? So angry black woman, right? Mammy, hypersexual black woman, you know, these notions of ourself that are kind of like who we are, right? Like, you know, I really like Angry Black Woman. She's my favorite of all the, because she's very useful. So, you know, you can keep her in your back pocket, and then when you need her in some kind of public space, you just whip her out. Right? So, like, you're standing there, 5'2", 105 pounds, people like, oh no, oh my God, here. Ridiculous. Right? But the truth is she's not actually useful because people don't hear that you're angry about something. They can't hear the content of it. Right? So she's only useful like in a grocery store parking lot or something. She's not actually useful for political organizing. She's not actually useful, for example, in a conversation, an intra-racial conversation about gender politics. So we have these moments, these images, and they're so skewed and they're so constant, and we're so bombarded with them that we start aligning ourselves with them, and we can feel like, oh, this is now my authentic self because I'm in line with them. We think we're standing straight up and down. We think that we have, here we are standing in line with our authentic self. Nope, all bend. Or sometimes, like, we're aware, oh, I heard about this experiment they're doing over in Carswell Hall, so make sure that you bend yourself the other way. So then we go acting all Miss Prim and Proper respectability politics, right? And so then we do strong Black woman, never angry, always quiet, you know, this whole situation, never engaging with anger, never engaging with sexuality, never engaging with any of those things because we know those stereotypes. We bend ourselves so far the other way because we're aware that we're in the experiment, that we're in the crooked room. We still also can't find our true north. So the crooked room metaphor that I'm using in the text is how that then impacts our capacity to engage politically. Mm-hmm. Because we are using so much both personal capital and social capital working on the angles of the crooked room that it becomes difficult to, you know, ask for both the recognition resources and the fair distribution of actual resources that are necessary to do the political work that we need.
And in your last chapter in Sister Citizen, you actually bring to bear an analysis on Michelle Obama's tenure as First Lady in terms of all of those stereotypes, defying those stereotypes, trying to break out of a crooked room. You have this wonderful analysis, which I've shared with some of my students this semester, of her 2009 portrait. Right, if you'll remember, this is the portrait where Michelle Obama was photographed with bare arms, and there was all of this to-do, which connected with this idea of hypersexuality. But then you pointed out something that I had entirely missed, which do you want
my
to?
My favorite thing in the world!
You can fill it in.
She is not just standing there in bare arms. Ladies and gentlemen, she is standing there in bare arms in front of a portrait of Thomas Jefferson.
Exactly. Exactly.
Ah! Oh my God, I love that shit so much. There is no way in the world that is an accident. Oh my God.
There's no way it's an accident.
There's no way it's an accident. Thomas Jefferson is just in there like, oh my God. Oh shit. Oh, and let me tell you how I know it's not an accident, because the last major political speech that she gives as First Lady at the DNC, she's like, and I wake up in a house built by slaves.
That's right. That's right.
It's highly enjoyable. It's really.
Ooh. But here's a
yes,
point. Here's
sorry.
No. I read your analysis and I had the same swooning feeling. But what was fascinating to me is that you end up saying in that chapter, even though she has had she has enjoyed a higher rating than her husband, higher than other first ladies in the last couple of decades, escaped the crooked room seemingly, that has not extended itself to other Black women in America.
Mm-mm.
So what must we do? I mean, we can't all become first ladies. What do you think now, having seen the last several years, what is an answer or a beginning of an answer?
Right. So it's important to remember that stereotypes and myths do not exist because of who you are, and therefore can't be undone because of who you are. They exist because of the work they do for those who are in power.
Right.
So there's really not anything you can do to undo them, right? So it's that horrifying meme that goes around the internet every so often of Oprah Winfrey saying that you know, like accomplishment and greatness, or, you know, like intelligence and hard work, you know, will overcome racism.
Right.
like the slaves are just lazy, like they're just chilling. Or they were like a little dim or something. I mean, no. I mean, it's like patently false, right? The Jezebel stereotype doesn't exist in slavery, in a period of enslavement, because enslaved African women are actually lascivious breeders. It's not like they could have, like, you know, tightened it up and been a little more, you know, ethical in their sexual practices, and then, you know, white men would have caught on that they were, you know, no, right? It's not as though, you know, if only domestic workers had been a little less, you know, attached to the white women that they work for, people would have figured out they weren't mammies. I mean, what? Nah. That's just not, you know, that those exist because they do work to reproduce white supremacy and patriarchy, and, right? So, you know, your job is not to go to college and not get raped.
Right.
Okay. So the work of the Crooked Room is to try to figure out how to stand up straight, not how to undo the stereotypes, right? They exist. And they're gonna produce some new, fascinating ones, undoubtedly. It's to be able to recognize them, to see them, to name them, to figure out the work that they're doing, to understand the ways that they impact the political work that we're interested in, to see our connections with those and the other kinds of dishonest work. So also, I'll say, you know, I'm doing the work in Sister Citizen not because black women are the only folks who labor, but because this is one story to tell that than other marginalized. So in fact, actually, I'm drawing a ton of this from queer theory, right? So particularly kind of the shame work actually comes out of queer theory, which is doing sort of, you know, if you think about the notion of gay pride, right? So gay pride is actually a pushback against gay shaming, right? So like why is gay pride important, right? Because the work of heteronormativity is shaming, right? So how does shaming work, right? Shaming works through this kind of Crooked Room work, right? So it's not as though this is the only this is the only community or the only space where it works. You know, we're watching, like, Donald Trump's whole initial campaign, right, was around shaming around not only Latino identity, but particularly around identity for folks who are undocumented, right? That's what the whole sort of initial campaign is like, let me build you a Crooked Room to go stand in. So I just say all that to say, so the work is to become sufficiently authenticated. Individual authentication is great, and that's part of like the work of college. But really, like, collective authentic work for the purposes of political engagement. So that we're not doing respectability politics, where what we're trying to do is to earn our right as citizens to make claims on the state by showing what good, valuable, upright people we are. But instead, right, what we're doing is saying, I don't really care if I'm crooked. What I deserve as a human being is, right, these sets of recognitions and resources from the state. You know, I wrote this now an embarrassingly long time ago, but it's highly enjoyable to me to watch the young people of the Black Lives Matter movement, most of whom I'm sure have never read the book, have figured that out all on their own. So, and it's also highly enjoyable to me to watch Congressman John Lewis love the fact that the young people of the Black Lives Matter movement have worked it out. So, like, a lot of the old civil rights guys are like, oh my God, why won't they pull up their pants? And John Lewis is like, hell yeah, kids! Screw them pants! I just, yes, John Lewis and the Black Lives Matter, you know, sagging pants. I just, because they're just like, nah, we're gonna come as we are and demand our rights. And I just, very highly appreciative of it. Yes.
Well, you've said a lot there.
Yes,
for me to follow
I'm sorry.
Up on. That's
many
right.
words,
that's
and
right.
also always like
all good.
John Lewis.
Well, let me pick up on on a couple of threads. I'm glad that you mentioned that you build off of a work of queer activists and scholars. I mean, obviously, Sister Citizen is an echo of Audre Lorde's Sister Outsider, and the idea that sister outsiders now need to be thought of as sister citizens. I'll come back to that, because I have a burning question about that, connected to your work with the Anna Julia Cooper Center. Yeah. But also,
I know, whose terribly respectability politics, it must be like at all points, like, oh my God.
Well,
pull your pants up, girl. Yes, I know.
Certainly accused of that, but on the other hand, broke through a lot of crooked rooms, right, to achieve the things that she did. But you mentioned rape culture, and there is a section of your book that deals with that in terms of the Duke lacrosse team and that whole incident. At the time, exonerated for the rape of a black woman who it was found out later had made a claim that was untrue. But my thought was, and I saw some memes floating around today, you know, but with the start of the new school year, where young feminists of different backgrounds are saying, I need feminism because I'm going to orientation and I'm being told how not to get raped as opposed to ending rape, right? And so given all of the things that have gone on since this book was published, I wondered, I mean, we have so many cases now that are high profile. What happened in Oklahoma last year, the cop who got 263 consecutive years, you know, for raping mostly black women, which is really an unheard of sentence. If we go back to Kimberly Crenshaw's work in intersectionality, demonstrating, in fact, that there's a lack of prosecution of cases against women of color. Mm-hmm. We see that now happening in Baltimore. Yep. There is the case in California with a young man who raped a peer and has gone very little time. What would you write now, or what would you say now about what needs to change in our culture and ways in which we can participate in making that change happen?
So I want to start by saying that the question of seeing long prison sentences or prison sentences at all as like the victory that we seek is troubling for me. You know, I spend so much of my time with a critique of the American system of criminal justice that it is very difficult for me to, on Monday, say, you know, the American system of criminal justice is one that is primarily not doing the work of rehabilitation, that doesn't understand all of the ways in which those who commit crimes are often themselves prior victims, and that is sort of, you know, patently and inherently unfair in a variety of ways, that does warehousing. I mean, I've just read an extraordinary book that everyone should read, Heather Thompson's book about the 1971 Attica uprising. I mean, you know, the Daniel Holtzclaw case in Oklahoma, and the conversations I've had with attorney Ben Crump, who we all probably nationally were introduced to in the case of Trayvon Martin and George Zimmerman, who prosecuted that case. You know, I understand why we think of like a prosecution, a conviction, and a sentence as a win, because that's all we have. But I do want us to always pause there, because like, you know, like my critique of the system is a critique of the system all the time. And so when I think about systems of justice that are changing how we would think about policing and how we would think about crime and how we would think about punishment, they are those that would rethink that in all of these spaces. And as I was saying to students earlier, that I don't say that lightly, given that I am a survivor of childhood sexual assault.
I'll say that makes two of us.
So. And probably many, many more
many
of us. So what that leaves us then with is, so if I'm going to start to answer the question of, so then what needs to change? I mean, there's one set of answers if the question is, how do we get more convictions, right? How do we get more convictions is like how we change rules of evidence, and that's how we end up with rape shield laws, and how, you know, that's different than how we, because I heard you ask sort of two sets of questions. One was, once we've had perpetration and crime, how we get some measure of justice, because we were talking about high profile cases where it feels like no one is held to account, which is also part of the agony of so many of the cases that have made up at least the high profile questions of Black Lives Matter, where part of what we feel like is, we're looking at death and destruction of Black bodies where no one is held to account, and part of it is just this like screaming question of, doesn't anyone care? And so that same question around rape, where people are broken and lost, and you're saying, does no one care? And the resounding answer seems to be like, no, hell no, does nobody care? We're trying to go live and do other things. Then the second question is, how do we stop the brokenness from occurring, right? I do not have the answer to either one of those questions. If I did, I would intervene immediately. I have a 14-year-old daughter. I spent much of my summer kind of clutching my chair, quite honestly, because the summer that I was 14 is the summer that I was raped. And I don't even think I quite realized the amount of trauma I was experiencing watching my kid hit that age. It took me a minute to figure out exactly what it was that was freaking me out all summer. And like, you know, like what we can't do is lock our gorgeous, beautiful, brilliant, exploring the earth world, you know, girl people in a basement somewhere, which was what my initial response was, right? My very first thought was, hey, we're gonna go sit in a dark basement all summer. That seems like what we should do, right? But no, of course, it's precisely the age when the number one thing we need to do is like, we're gonna have a little bit more freedom. Now we're gonna learn some responsibility. We're going to high school and we gotta learn to like go outside and be by ourselves and say, you know, take your phone and just let me know when you get there. Learn some responsibility, take some actions on our own, and you know, have some hard conversations. I mean, I guess if I had some sons, I could lock their asses up, but I don't.
But it seems to me that part of the answer, I mean, we don't have the ready-made answers, but part of the answer is participating in a culture of transformation and change, right, is being able to voice the unspeakable, being able to be a witness to our own pain, being able, we can't
maybe,
prevent.
But I gotta tell you, these motherfuckers on Twitter who, like, are all like, I'm a Black feminist, new man, blah, 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 and they're like, I mean, Nate Parker didn't, I mean, she, I mean, you just got.
There's a lot of teaching we still need to do.
But see, I do, I know, I just blocked them all. So I guess for me, so it's an interesting question about like how we participate in that. Because for me, I just like, once you did that, I was actually not gonna participate anymore.
Right.
So if we had been like engaged in a social media world together, like progressive friends, and then this moment happened, and your response to it was, I mean, Nate Parker, I mean, we wasn't there. Block, mute, silent, unfollow, nope. Because actually, nah.
No,
I hear you.
I'm
just, nope. Actually, we're not, no. Because I'm, maybe at 17, but I am 43. So if you are anywhere around my age, and there was any confusion for you about whether or not that moment was rape, and whether or not any of us still have a right to talk about it, then nah. Actually, I'm not going to participate in, nah, I'm good.
I'm totally fine. Agreed. But that's what I'm talking about. That's what I'm talking about. And that leads into, I think, will be my final question before we open up to the floor, which is really what inspired me in your book was the fact that you were inspired by so many Black feminist writers before you. And I'm in literature, and I saw that you quoted Zora Neale Hurston quite a bit. And there is a conversation in her 1937 text about rape culture, even in that day, about how one liberates oneself from fear. How does one pursue one's dreams? Our first year students are reading that book this semester, so I thought, oh, this is a great confluence of moments here. And for me as a Haitian, very interesting too, because she wrote that novel in Haiti in Port-au-Prince, which many people don't know. And you tied that in, this is gonna be a sort of a layered question, but you tied that into your rethinking the coverage of Hurricane Katrina, right? The way in which she talked about a hurricane in Florida and how she survived it and had to make the most difficult decision, which was to sacrifice the love of her life, right, TK, which of course, who was not, you know, a Nate Parker, but, you know, having to make that sacrifice.
Well, a little bit.
In some ways, yeah, absolutely, in terms of domestic violence, yes. And so, but you drew from that to really have your readers think about the ways in which Black women's bodies have been misused in the coverage of Katrina. And I, reading this, was thinking about, I used to also live in Louisiana, in Baton Rouge, the coverage of the floods, which most of my friends in Baton Rouge have said is not really not being covered, right? And we know that Baton Rouge has a large population of poorer Black people. Yeah. And so it seems to me that we do have somewhere to draw from, right? People like Hurston and Shange and Lord and Chisholm and Cooper. And you're part of that tradition, you know, in terms of joining your forces to their, what you're inheriting from these women. And so I'm wondering if you can just speak a little bit about the inspiration you've drawn from those texts, specifically from Hurston, and anything else you'd like to say about what's happening right now in terms of coverage in Louisiana.
And so I'll also acknowledge back the work that your work, you drawing out from Danticat, from Haitian writers, from Cuban writers. So when you take us to New Orleans, you take us, of course, to a city that is both American but also Caribbean.
That's true.
Global in that sense. And the ways in which, right, to be citizen has also always meant to be male.
Yes.
Right, and so your work drawing on their work, that is to say that at that intersection, right, that they insist upon the intersectional definition of citizenship, that what happens if we look at citizen, and citizen here less as a legal definition, right, but as a sense of belonging, of identity, of the national story, right, being told through the story of women.
Right.
So that's part of what I'm trying to do with the retelling of the story of Hurricane Katrina through Hurston. But it's, I guess I would just say two things. It's both an issue of necessity, because I'm an empirical social scientist by graduate training, and the reality is that, look, there are, the data are sparse for people of color, and even more so, for women of color, so much so that, I mean, this is the work that the Anna Julia Cooper Center is currently doing with our collaborative project. You know, the work that we have that we've been doing since November to really bring on these other institutions in the collaborative to advance equity through research to say that the data are so sparse at the intersections of understanding race and gender that we don't even know what the right questions to ask are. So just real quick, and I promise I'm gonna come back to literature.
Sure.
So for example, we knew, I would say prison to, school to prison pipeline, right? School to prison pipeline, school to prison pipeline. And people sort of knew or thought they knew what that meant for students of color. And I would say students of color, but really what we meant was black boys, right? And it was a reasonable kind of thing to talk about because we had collected those data, but those data were really about black boys, school to prison pipeline, and it was about a set of disciplinary actions enacted on black boys that was leading to juvenile incarceration and adult incarceration and all of this. Soon as we asked the question, what about black girls? All of a sudden, a whole new set of disciplinary experiences opened up. So this is Monique Morris's work in Push Out. It turns out that the pipeline is a school to prison pipeline, but through a totally different route. It's a sexual assault to prison pipeline. So what we really see is that the vulnerability is mostly for young women and girls who are in the foster system or other systems where their first vulnerability exposure is childhood sexual assault. That childhood sexual assault leads to a set of disciplinary experiences in school. Those disciplinary experiences in school lead to school pushout. That school pushout then leads to the prison pipeline. Totally different story, totally different set of public policies necessary to address it.
Right.
But if you don't ask, and you don't have those data, you've got the wrong interventions. You actually have to ask about the girls.
Right.
Okay. So when I go to write this book, part of the problem was I had a whole set of questions and no data and no money. I was a junior faculty member. So it turns out that the people who had asked a bunch of questions about the black girls and the black women and provided some answers were writers, right? So social scientists failing at asking those questions, but writers had been asking them. So for example, I really wanted to think about shame. Toni Morrison, she'd written a whole book about that in the 1970s. It was called Bluest Eye.
Right.
And she'd mapped shame at the intersections of black girlhood through the Bluest Eye and Pecola and sexual assault and what that would do and the manifestations of that. And in fact, when you map that story onto what we actually know about shame and its manifestations, it's perfect. Like, she totally got it in the mid-1970s. We just didn't have those data to map it, but I had to tell the story, so I had to go tell it with Pecola. I had one data set that we had gone and collected ourselves from the University of Chicago on Katrina, but I just didn't, I mean, there's a lot more Katrina data now, but there weren't a lot then. So I needed a black lady in a hurricane. Guess who had written that? Hurston. Janie Mae Crawford, Hurston, right? So part of it was a necessity. The other part of it was I was an English major in college. And so this was my opportunity to go and finally spend some time connecting those parts that had, I think, probably first brought me to what I understood to be politics. So it's a little bit like the MS show, right? Like, for me, politics had never just been like who's ahead and who's behind. It had always been all of these other pieces. And so, when I look at what happened to my family and to my neighbors in New Orleans, it is not just a story about how many bodies were pulled from the Superdome or the streets. It really is a story about citizenship. It really is a story about belonging. It really is a story about who's in and who's out, about who counts, about what we think rebuilding is. I think for me, one of the most difficult weekends I ever had was having to do coverage of the 10th anniversary. and watching people take a victory lap around that city, particularly around those schools, which were mostly destroyed, and watching people say, watching the Obama administration education department in the person of Arne Duncan say that the New Orleans schools were better, which is a lie. And I was just openly disgusted with the entire 10th. And it was hard, but it was also kind of wonderfully subversive, because I could go get all my like totally lefty, all my like Black Lives Matter, damn near communist, feminist friends and put them on the TV. And they could just be like, Obama sucks, Arne Duncan sucks, housing sucks, Mitch Landrieu sucks, all this ain't shit. Yes. And I was like, hell yeah, I have a TV show. Let's do it. It was great. And those are really, like, when I think about when I miss TV, like, that's really when, I don't miss TV 99% of the time, but, like, just, like, moments like that, I'm like, oh, man, that was great. Like, yes, love that. That's the kind of thing that was fabulous. I really did enjoy that.
So for all of you out there who are undeclared majors, English might be a way to start.
The other thing I said to the other young women earlier was, every time I'm engaged in a situation and we are in commencement and some student goes popping across the stage talking about, woo, this is great, I'm gonna be back next weekend. I'm like, we failed. Anybody who graduates college and had just like a grand time. You should be so like intellectually exhausted and a little socially and personally and emotionally stressed the out from college that you should not be back to homecoming for 2, 3, 4, 5 years. You should not be able to come back over here. Like when the mail comes, you should be like, I can't deal with that just yet. You shouldn't be able to quite process it all. You should just be like walking down the street when you're about 26, be like, that's what that meant? Oh, hell. I just got that. You should like call your professor, be like, I just got that. Oh my God, I'm so sorry. Oh, I just got that. Oh shit, can I rewrite that? Because I just got that. Like, it should be hard. So every time I see a student who's just like right back over that piece, we have failed. Because it's supposed to be brutal. Not like breaking your soul, but breaking your whole head. Just gray matter just running down like that. So if you occasionally feel that way, congratulations. That's what's supposed to be called.
Well, Melissa and Sister Citizen with a wonderful quote from Shirley Chisholm, where at the end of that quote she says, the most important thing is to be true to oneself. And I think Melissa has exhibited that beautifully today. She also promised this spring that she would remain challenging and unpredictable. She's proven that this evening. So let's thank Melissa Harris-Perry for her time. Thank you.